Your name be glorified in this service. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Please be seated. I am very glad this morning, and it is a privilege for me that God, through my father, my mentor, Apostle Emmanuel Akwa, has given me this platform. It is a privilege to be able to stand before the children of God and to minister to them and to give them the mind of God. This morning I am coming to give you a message with the title, The Battle for Relevance. The battle for relevance. We are a children of God and we live in the kingdom of God. Therefore, any battle that a child of God is involved in, it must be a battle that is part of the purpose and the plan of God. And so if you are in any battle which is not part of the purpose and the plan of God, it is a battle which is of no relevance. So this morning, I am here to give you a key. There is a mystery about keys. You see, a key is a very small thing. It can be put somewhere in the corner of your pocket. But the same key is what you need to open a mighty door. The door that you cannot carry. It takes the key that is hidden somewhere in the corner of your pocket to open it. Therefore, if you ignore a key, you will be left behind the door. This morning, I pray that you shall not ignore the key that is coming your way. And I am also here to show you how you can go through a wall. Sometimes the children of God do not come across doors. So you may be having a key, all right. But then when you come behind the wall of Jericho, you don't need a key. What you need is another mystery that God is giving us today. Therefore, this morning, God is giving us a key to open the door. But He's also giving us a key and a mystery to pass through a wall. A mystery that will make the wall of Jericho collapse in your life. If you believe it, shout, I believe. If you believe, shout, I believe.
I believe.
God bless you. Relevance is a word that if you don't take care, you might never actually understand it fully. When we say something is relevant, what we mean is the degree to which that thing is related or connected. Or it is required for what we are doing currently, or a subject matter which is currently being discussed. So in any point in the life of men, God is always having a program and an agenda. In all the generations of man, God has a program and an agenda. Those who are relevant to the program and the agenda of God are those who are closely connected with God. So for you to be relevant in the program of God at any era, you must be connected with God. And you must not just be connected with God, you must know the the plan and the program of God in that era. So there is a time like today. You see, every man can be anointed. Every pastor can be anointed. Every prophet can be anointed. Every man of God can be anointed. But the fresh oil, the anointing for now, God gives to those who are in the same mind with them and who have availed themselves to Him to become relevant for His current program. Oh, I pray that we understand this way. I pray seriously that we understand this way. One thing that I know and I like about Christianity is that the entire concept of God, as far as we know it, is based on the word. So when the word is coming like this, I am praying that everyone will receive the word. Moses said the last time that he was reminding the Israelites that the day that God descended and spoke with you, you did not see any figure. So it doesn't take any figure to know God. You did not see any form. So it doesn't take any form to know God. You only heard the word of God. So what you saw on the mountain like fire, it wasn't God, but it was the word that you received. So when Jesus was speaking to the disciples, he said in John chapter 6, the word that I speak to you, they are spirits and they are life. If the word is coming like this, I want you to put your hand on your head and pray this short prayer. Say, Father, open my mind, open the eyes of my understanding. Let me receive your word in the name of Jesus Christ. The word rich. The word rich. Not my name Richie, but the word rich was first used in the Bible to describe a man called Abraham. In the whole Bible, the first person whom the Bible used the word rich to describe is Abraham. The Bible says Abraham was walking with the Lord, and according to Genesis chapter 13, verse 1, the Bible says that, when you read from the verse 2 going, for us to make it short, Pastor, read it for me. Genesis chapter 13, verse 2.
Genesis chapter 13.
Verse 2.
Verse number
2.
And I read verse 2. Now Abraham was extremely rich.
Extremely rich.
In livestock and in silver.
It's okay, Pastor. God bless you. He was the first person that the word rich was used to describe. And the Bible says he was extremely rich. Extremely rich. The word rich, in the Hebrew language, is the word kabad.
Kabad.
Now, kabad in the Hebrew language can mean rich. It can also mean honor. So when the Bible was talking about Jabez, when he said Jabez was more honorable than his brothers, the word honorable that he used in describing Jabez is the same word that was used in describing Solomon, Abraham. But with Abraham, God said, or the Bible just said, he is rich. But with Jabez, the Bible said he is honorable. The word kabad can mean rich, it can mean honorable, it can mean plenty, it can mean abundance, it can mean manifold, it can mean multiplied, it can be made to be relevant, such that you cannot ignore. This morning I pray in the name of Jesus, by the end of this word, may you become relevant in your community. May you become your family, may you become relevant in this congregation. May you become relevant in this generation. If we are looking for relevant people, may you be counted among them in the name of Jesus. So when the Bible talked about Abraham being rich, he said Abraham was compact. And in 1 Chronicles chapter 4 verse 9, the Bible says God blessed Jabez and he became honorable. But then there is a key, and the key to being honorable, God has given it to us. How did God give it to us? God gave it to us when he gave us this scripture. He says in 1 Samuel chapter 2 verse
30.
1 Samuel chapter 2 verse 30.
1 Samuel 2 and 30.
He says, I will honor those who honor me. I will honor those who honor me. In other words, in the Hebrew language, God was saying, I will combat those who combat me. So for you to become honorable, for you to become rich, you must know the key. And the key is that you must know how to honor God. Because without honoring God, God cannot honor you. Without honoring God, God cannot honor you. There is a way of becoming rich. There is an earthly rich, and there is a heavenly giving riches. For you to become earthly rich, you can choose to honor the devil. He said to Jesus, if you will honor me by bowing to me, I will give you all the riches of this world. So don't be deceived. There are some people who can honor the devil, and the devil can make them earthly rich. But for you to become relevantly rich, I told you this word called kabad, it is not just a simple word. It means to be relevantly rich, so that your riches is more relevant to the entire generation. So for you to get that, you don't have to honor the devil, but you have to honor God. That is why he has said, if you honor me, I will honor you. How do we honor God? How do we honor God? There are so many ways of honoring God. The Bible says you can honor the Lord with your praises. The Bible says you can honor the Lord with your praises. But you can also honor the Lord with your substances. You can honor the Lord with your substances. But when we talk about substance, what do we mean? In Proverbs chapter 3 verse 9. Pastor, read it for us. Proverbs chapter 3 verse 9. The Bible says we should honor God in a certain way. Proverbs 3 9.
Proverbs chapter 3 verse
9.
It says, honor the Lord with your capital or your sufficiency or your substance from righteous labors. And with the fruitful or the first fruit of all your income.
Hallelujah. Amen. Pastor, God bless you. So the Lord was giving us the key how to honor God. And he said, for you to honor me, so that you will retain the same, I will retain the same honor to you. You must honor me with your capital, with your substances, with your work, with the fruit of your labor, with the first fruits of your labor. This is what I expect you to honor me with. And the moment you will honor me with that substance, I, the Lord, will also honor you with the same substance. So it doesn't take much to honor God. It doesn't take much. It doesn't take much. All what it takes is what is in your hand. All what it takes is what is in your hand. There is a way of honoring God if you are a widow. The widow's mite. The widow's mite. The widow's mite. The widow's mite. Now, Jesus Christ said, At the day that he entered into the temple, they were giving offering. The widow brought her mite. The widow's mite was all what she had. She gave it to Anako. This widow, her name has been mentioned anywhere the gospel has been preached. There is a woman who took an ornament and he honored God with the ornament. And Jesus said, for what this woman has done, everywhere the gospel will be preached, her name will be mentioned there. There is a way of honoring God such that you are becoming relevant through all generations. Abraham was relevant, and not in one generation. The Bible says that Abraham honored God. The day that Abraham honored God, God blessed Abraham. And then he said about Abraham, you, and for you, Abraham, I am blessing you with a blessing. The blessing that I am blessing you is such that through all generations, your descendants will be God blessed. And anyone who curses your descendants will be cursed. Anyway, the other way is that that curse will not stand. The other way is that anyone who curses the descendants of Abraham, the curse doesn't stand. The curse doesn't stand. But the positive side is that whoever blesses Abraham shall be blessed. There is an aura around people who honor God. There is an aura around people who honor God. This aura is such that even if they are honoring God and you become friends with them, automatically you start getting blessed. There was a man called Joseph. He traveled into a land called Egypt. In the land of Egypt, he was sold as a slave into the house of Potiphar. He entered into the house of Potiphar as a slave. But the Bible says the presence of Joseph brought abundant blessing in the house of Potiphar. There is a way that people who carry the blessings of God, they can even bless you unannounced. They bless you and you don't even know. There is a way that you come around them, and even if you are destined to die, you start receiving life. This morning, because of your connection with this church, I pray, may you receive honor. May you become relevant in the plan of God. May you become relevant in the will of God. May the purposes of God be performed through you, because you are a member of this church. Because you have visited the church today, you that has watching us online, because you have decided to spend your time to watch Trust in God, may you be honored. May your life change. May you become relevant in this generation. May you become relevant in your family. In the name of Jesus Christ. I am building a point. Pardon me, I will finish very soon. For anyone to become useful at any point in time, or valuable. Anyway, every human being in this world today, the most important thing to us is for us to become valuable and useful. If you are a man, the only thing that is more important to you is what will make you valuable to others. So if you don't think about that, you are not in heaven. You see, when you are with your wife, when you are with your wife and you do something that makes her feel irrelevant, she becomes very offended. Even your children, when you do something and they become irrelevant or they feel irrelevant, you offend them. So for us to become relevant is the most important thing.
Genesis chapter 22.
Verse 16 to 18.
And I read verse 16. And said, I have sworn myself, says the Lord, that since you have done this and have not withheld from me or begrudged giving me your son, your only son, verse 17. In blessing, I will bless you, and in multiplying, I will multiply you. Your descendants, like the stars of the heavens, and like the sand of the seashore, and your seed or your head will possess the gates of your enemies.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
The Bible is talking about a man called Abraham. And he's saying that Abraham, because you have done this, in blessing I will bless you. What did Abraham do? Abraham sacrificed or decided, accepted. Was on the verge. Nothing stopped Abraham. Not his own mind. Not his sense. Not his wife. Not his family. Not his teacher. Not his image in the community. Because Abraham had only one son. You see, he had already committed himself. At this point, when God asked for the life of Isaac, Abraham had no backup. And he was old. And for your information, Sarah was already old when she gave birth to Isaac. And now Isaac is a teenager. And God is saying, give him to me. So there was no backup. But Abraham did not think about all this. He just gave Isaac. The Bible says he prepared the altar. He put the firewood on the altar. He put the child on the altar. Abraham is referred to as the friend of God. There are times we don't understand how can God form special relationship with certain people. There are certain people in the Bible, God has formed special relationship with them. And he even has a way of addressing them. Abraham, my friend. Abraham, my friend. There is no also another one called David. The Bible says that
David
was a small boy, but he never abandoned his God. Even in his childhood, he knew his God. He chose to walk with the Lord. Walking in the Lord is not a mouth talk. People who walk with the Lord, there are things around them that should. If you walk with the Lord, you don't go with your mouth. If you walk with the Lord, you don't go with your clothes. If you walk with the Lord, you go with your substance. You go with your substance. Everything that you have, you go with the Lord. And you don't leave anything behind. You don't leave some behind. And say, I am going to worship God. I have evidence. This man, Ahmed, go to the extent that he said, the anointed one of the Lord, I, David, I will not touch. If you are a pastor here, if you are a church elder here, if you are a church member here and you think you are so intelligent, I am telling you something. David was anointed. Saul David knew. When David had the opportunity to touch the anointed one of God, because of the kind of respect he had for the Lord, he said, I will not touch the anointed one. Sometimes we feel like we are the pastors. So we too, we have been anointed. So we can talk just anyhow about another pastor. We can just touch the anointed one of God. It doesn't matter how they have erred. You do not have the right to touch them. You do not have the right to touch them. This is a sign of somebody who has chosen to walk with the Lord. Well, Papa may be chasing me to kill me, but if I truly walk with the Lord and honor God, I dare not open my mouth and insult Apostle Emmanuel Papa. I dare not open my mouth and touch him with my lips, with my hand, with my actions. David sacrificed everything to the extent that even what was rightfully his, he gave it to the Lord. Rightfully his, in the sense that God had told David that you are now the king. It is you that I have chosen. But David knew God. He knew the ways of God. He knew that at the right time, God himself is strong enough to remove Saul and put him there. So he dared not take things into his own hands. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I am going somewhere. I will read there very soon. And then we will pray and close. I am going somewhere. David became a king. But do you know, for your information, that for those who are relevant to God, they are always connected to the house of God. They are always connected to the house of God. Let me give you a brief timeline. This is how it happened. Abraham was the first one. Abraham was traveling. He reached a place in the land of Canaan. And then he made an altar there. And sacrificed to the Lord there. And continued his journey. Years later, his grandson, the son of Isaac, called Jacob, is also traveling. Then he comes to the same piece of land where Abraham built the altar and sacrificed there. He didn't know. He just laid down to sleep. In his sleep, he had a dream. And in the dream, he saw the heavens opened. And there was a ladder connecting that place to the heavens. So Jacob said, hey, this place is the house of God. And I knew not. Then he stood there and made a vow that, Lord, if you will take me to where I am going and I return, I will make this place your house. And in this place, we will call upon your name. Not too far. One day, in so many years, the children of Israel had been in slavery in the land of Egypt. And God had brought them back into the land of Canaan. According to the plan of God, only those who are relevant shall receive the power of God. So they returned to the land of Canaan. And when they returned, they made a king. They decided to choose a king and reject God as a king. So they chose Saul. God gave them Saul. Saul became their king. Then for some reasons, God rejected Saul and decided to take David. When David became king, he adopted the strategy of Abraham. David was one person. He sacrificed like a madman. He would sacrifice anyhow. According to the lifeline and the history of the Israelites, it is only Abraham that can sacrifice that way. God bless you, Mama. God made a promise that your descendants, I will bless them. Those who connect themselves with this promise, they become relevant for was looking for somebody who will open up the gates to connect the heaven with the ground. Remember, the children of Israel had worked for so many years, and God didn't have a close connection with them. Anytime God wanted to speak with them, he had to come. He had to come down. But it was time for God to come and make his house among men and to live with the children of men. And God was looking for somebody who would devote himself solely to him so that he would come through him. The Bible says that David, though he sinned, though he erred, though he did something wrong, through what he did, David decided to seek the face of the Lord. Therefore, he went to the field of Onan. He went to the field of Onan because the prophet had told him that you have to choose a place and make a sacrifice to the Lord. If you make a sacrifice to the Lord, your sacrifice, then in that place the Lord will pardon you and the Lord will stop slaughtering the children of God. So David went to the field of Onan. Let's read 1 Chronicles chapter 21. It shall be our closing scripture. 1 Chronicles chapter 21. It is our closing and dedicatory scripture. Verse 25.
Verse number 25.
Yes.
First Chronicle 21, 25.
Yes.
So David gave to Onan for the site 600 shekels of gold by weight.
Continue.
Okay.
Read it again. For emphasis, read it again.
Okay.
So David
gave to Onan for the sight of 600 shekels of gold by weight.
Some versions call him Aruna. Some versions call him Onan. The Bible says David carried 25 shekels of gold and used it as payment for the land. This land belonged to the children of Israel. But legally, it did not belong to David. Onan decided to give it to David for free. But David said, I will not use anything that has not touched me. Something that I have not paid for. Something that has not cost me. I will not use it to honor my God. So David had to carry 25 shekels of gold and give it to Onan. Sacrifice.
Are you sacrificing?
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I pray for you this morning. That may your sacrifice touch the Lord. I pray for you this morning. So there is a way. When the Israelites reached Jericho, there was a wall. And the Bible says the wall that that was built around Jericho was as big to the extent that 8 chariots could run on it. Hello. What offense was that? Yes, you said upon 8. That's the stuff she says. I'm winning out to get to the house. So I will live in a man here. Yeah, dear, I'm it is our. So that a people who are still depend to be passing. Hello? Me say, what are not Jerry Cook first? So what are the people from Pussy and then you can depend to be passing? Because they would have said, and she said, aha, any area. So when the Israelites reached there, God didn't have to give them a king, but God gave them a mighty warrior. He gave them the warrior which is the Lord of the armies of heaven. So he appeared suddenly, and Joshua said, are you for me or you are against me? And then he said, I am the Lord or the leader of the armies of heaven. Hello. I am telling you the truth. You are lost. Unless it is the Lord that is leading you, you are lost. So don't think about whether you get rich or not. Just sacrifice. Even if you take everything that you have, let the Lord lead you and just sacrifice. The Lord is our leader. So there is a wall that we don't need to climb. According to the analysis that we just made,
it was
If you will agree with me, the wall of Jericho didn't just collapse. It sank. It sank. Because if it had collapsed just like that, the rubies would still have been a wall. And they would have been difficult for them to pass through. It sank. The Bible says, those who honor me, I will make the mountain sink in front of them. And I will raise the valley so that the mountain and the valley will become equal. In your sight, when you walk, you shall know all kinds of valleys. The Lord will make you like a vine tree with the strength to creep over walls. And you will creep over the wall. He will make you get the strength and the wisdom to pass through the wall. You will become mysterious in your generation. There is a reason. You know, the church of God, we made so many mistakes. And I stand here as a young child of God to speak wisdom. As many as will hear me, let us begin to correct this mistake. It is true that Solomon was a man of sacrifice. It is true that Solomon asked for the wisdom to judge the children of God. But do we know that Solomon erred in what he did? I am coming here to give you a key. And this key is not what gives you money. There are some things that money can buy. This one, money can buy. Hello? Everyone who has money can buy this one. Is it true?
Yes.
If you have money, you can buy this one. You need this to buy this. But what do you need to get this? What in the world do you need to get money? We have been taught that we need to go to school. We need a job. Hello? I have seen somebody who is a professor. Done all the academic works in the world. Done everything that is must be done. He never had what it takes to get this. Because this thing is being distributed. Some may get it in pieces. There are those who get it in abundance. Solomon got it in abundance to the extent that he didn't know what to do with some. The Bible says that he started laying roads with gold. Hallelujah. So, what do you need to get money? You need God. You need God. You need God. You need to walk with God. The Bible says everything in this world, all money, all substances, everything that exists in this world belongs to Him. If you don't have Him, you don't have it. Don't fake it. This is the error of Solomon. After Solomon sacrificed, the Lord came to him. The Bible reports that Solomon himself made a testimony before God that, Father, my father Abraham walked with you and you blessed him and you gave him this throne. And now I have become a king. Now I ask for the wisdom to judge your people. Solomon asked for the wisdom to judge the people of God. Solomon asked for the wisdom to judge the people of God. For the governance of this world, if you want to do it for God, you will need money. Even if you illegally become the president of Ghana, there are people who will be able to fund you so that you can run Ghana. So God, in His own wisdom, was pleased, all right, that Solomon asked for wisdom to judge His people. So He said, I will give you all what you need so that you will be able to judge my people. But then Solomon judged the people, all right. But then he started erring and erring and erring. One thing that Solomon relevant to men. Have you gone to any church and heard the people celebrating Kwame Nkrumah? He was only relevant to men. But I am giving you this lifeline. Abraham, Jacob, Isaac, David, Moses, Solomon. They are people who have been celebrated in churches. What is the difference? I tell you, you were born on the same day with me. But whether I will be celebrated in the church tomorrow, but you will not be celebrated in the church tomorrow, it depends on your motivation behind what you are doing for God. I am bringing my service to a close. My sermon is coming to a close. And I am telling you one thing. In the house of God, there are some who come there to fill the house. There are some who enter as leaders. There are some who enter as relevant people of God. There are millions of Israelites who have lived and died. But there are few who are relevant when it comes to the word of God and the agenda of God. The day that Jacob and Esau were being born, the Bible says they were struggling in their mother's womb. It was a struggle for relevance. The day that Isaac was about to die, these young men were able to decipher that and understand that for you to become relevant to God, you must know how to sacrifice. The kind of sacrifice that gives you the blessing. So they struggled over it. And the mother had to help the son to be able to win the sacrifice. So when he got it, it became Jacob and not Esau. The last thing. People who are not relevant, at times you are not even counted in the war. In battle, you are counted as a casualty. According to the book of Job, look at me, look at me. According to the book of Job, Job chapter 1. So, poor Joseph, Job, I was so adorable. And your name out there, man, it's not. Upa, the name out there, who be so adorable. And then, you have to catch them and say, and upon some point, in closing, I want you to know that if you develop a personal sacrificial life with the Lord, you become relevant to the extent that God cannot ignore you. So, who be who said it's powerful? I think I'm here for my dead year. Who be here to the extent that you to me, Emmanuel Judah? Abraham Job, when something is said, come. Bible says, not Job, they be our work for the man and man. But Bible and Canada, send a Job, man of work for the man. Instead, send a Job, man and man for the man. Job, man and man, who born yard of the years. It's your dad on something inside, and cut Job, and we are here. Praise the Lord. Who needs a one something to Job, man and man? No, we are here. No, we are here. But let me tell you, in the wars of this world, there is a law of engagement. Whatever the Lord brings forward becomes his subjects. Who makes many apostles up and say, the PR will actually more than the power for the end. So when you see out for the power, Apostle Lapa will become the friend of God and you will become the subjects. I am not saying you are yourself the subject. But what I'm trying to say is that I was saying who she has sent me power for the end. Send your bayah wouldn't have popo and cast a bayah on Kufa. And it's your dab on something and say, hey, cut your dog on your dear. Or proud dog with many now.
Daddy Pacho, Mamichiwa, Sadia Tene, a bit confusing. I can all patch and say, send your Sadia Yapa or church a yap for war. No, or one can say, example, any man for war, and what for money can go be. Say, Papa, that war for real. On the back of the year, just say, and I said, can you for the Abana Sanua? Why would you achieve one? Who shall it be? What about the year to say, which you didn't be taking? I just said, and for so many now, the baby did not get a muscle. And it is a kind of a muscle pen and a little woman. It is a shame about this ever opinion and Sally Brass also.
A T and I so for Jesus Christ. Amen.